Hi class, today we're going to talk about how to use the square root property in order to help you solve problems. And what we're going to do is take into consideration that square roots and squares are kind of opposite functions of each other. So you can use a square root to make it so that you can get rid of a square as long as that's the only thing that you have. So if you take a look at this particular square root property here, that if x squared equals a, then x will either be the square root of a or x will be the negative square root of a. So what this does is it takes into consideration the fact that a positive times a positive will give you a positive value, and a negative times a negative will also give you a positive value. So for instance, if I have x squared equals 4, and I wanted to simplify that and solve for x, what I could do is this property is saying that x will either be the positive square root of 4, which is 2, or it will be the negative square root of 4, which is negative 2. And that takes into consideration the fact that negative 2 times negative 2 is 4. So if I plugged a negative 2 in for x here, I would get 4. Or if I plug in 2 and do 2 times 2, I would also get a 4. Now, there's a couple ways to write your answers. You can write it like this. Or another way that you will often see is that x equals plus or minus 2. This is a plus or minus symbol there. It means exactly what I have written right here, that it's either the positive 2 or it's the negative 2. There's two answers there. What a lot of people will do when they're solving equations like this one here is they'll get to where you have what's being squared by itself, and then you'll square root both sides. And on the side with the numeric value, you put the plus or minus symbol in. This then will take you over to your next statement. The square and the square root will cancel each other out, and you end up with x equals plus or minus 2. So that's one way to show your work there. Now the key is you need to make sure what's being squared is by itself and that there isn't a linear term, which means you don't have an x to the first power in the problem also. Let's take a look at another one. Let's say that you happen to have 5x squared equals 100. The first thing we need to do is solve for that x squared. So I need to get the 5 to move to the other side, and since it's being multiplied, the opposite is to divide by it. So I'm going to divide both sides by 5. The 5's here cancel to make just an x squared. And 100 divided by 5 is 20. Now what I'm going to do is notice that I have a square, and I need to get rid of the square. The opposite of squaring is square rooting, so I'm going to square root both sides. And over here with my number, I'm going to insert my plus or minus. The square and the square root cancel to just give you an x, because the square root of x squared is x. And over on this other side, you need to keep in mind you do need to simplify your square root. So we need to take a look at 20 and see what's the largest perfect square that will go into 20. And 4 goes into 25 times. So I'm going to actually break this into plus or minus the square root of 4 times the square root of 5. The square root of 4 is 2, so this ends up being plus or minus 2 square root of 5. So always make sure you simplify your square root rather than doing a decimal approximation, unless you're in a story problem where it makes sense to use the decimal or you're asked for the decimal. Now let's take a look at one that's just slightly different, but we'll still be using this property. For instance, what if we had x minus 2 squared equals 36? For this particular problem, we don't have just an x squared, but we do have something that is squared. We have a x minus 2 that is being squared, and this item here that's being squared is all by itself on this side of the equation. So what we can do is square root both sides in order to get rid of this square outside the parentheses, and then we'll have something that we can continue solving with. So what we're going to do is square root both sides of the equation. Over here with your number, you're going to need to put a plus or minus. The square and the square root will cancel and leave you with just the x minus 2. And on the other side, square root of 36 is 6, so we'll have plus or minus 6. Now what we need to do is we need to move our 2 over. And since it's minus 2, we're going to add 2. When I insert the 2 over here with our number here, I always put it in front of the plus or minus. You'll see why in just a minute. So we have x equals 2 plus or minus 6. Now keep in mind that plus or minus was giving us 2 values, a positive 6 and a negative 6. So what we're going to do now is separate this into two problems that we'll solve to get our final solution. We're going to separate it into 2 plus 6, and also we're going to separate it into 2 minus 6. This first one here will give you your first value of 8, and the second one will give you your second value, which is a negative 4. So keep in mind that just because you are square rooting doesn't mean that both solutions will actually be the same number with one a plus and one a minus. If you're squaring something that has more than just a variable, you might end up with two values that aren't opposites of each other or inverses of each other. Now let's take a look at one more problem that is like this one we just did, but it's kind of disguised. For instance, what if we have x squared minus 10x plus 25 equals 7? This particular problem is just like the last one, but it's kind of disguised. The reason why is because this right here is not in factored form. If we factored it, we would find that it's very similar to the x minus 2 squared we had in the last problem. This has three terms, and the first term has a 1, so if we used our shortcut, we'd want to know what multiplies to get 25 and adds up to negative 10, and that's a negative 5 times a negative 5, which would make this x minus 5 times x minus 5, which is the same thing as x minus 5 squared. So this trinomial we have right here is what we call a perfect square. It's just disguised. And the reason why it's a perfect square is because we can factor it into something squared. So if you have something that is not in this form here, and you're supposed to be using the square root property, you might see if you can factor it from this form into that form to make something that you can actually solve. So now we're going to go ahead and square root both sides. We're going to insert our plus or minus right here with our 7, square root of 7, and the square and square root cancel, so we have an x minus 5, and over here we have plus or minus 7. Now let's move our 5 over by adding 5, and again, remember you insert it in front of the plus or minus. So x would equal 5 plus or minus square root of 7. This is, should have a square root on it. Now, keep in mind, it is perfectly fine to leave your solution in this form. It means two answers. However, you may need to actually write those two answers out. And if we were writing a solution set of this, the solution set would be 5 plus square root of 7 along with 5 minus square root of 7. So those would be your two solutions. Notice I did not get a decimal approximation for the square root of 7 and get two decimal answers. That's because those would not be exact answers, and unless I'm dealing with some kind of story problem that's wanting a decimal approximation, we want to leave them in square root form. Now let's look at one type of a situation where these square roots are often used. There is a formula called the theorem called a Pythagorean theorem that gives you a formula for right triangles only. If you have a right triangle, which means you have a right angle in here, the sum of the legs, which we're going to call length A and B, the sum of the squares of those legs, which would be A squared plus B squared, that's the sum of the squares, is going to be equal to the square of the hypotenuse, which is this longer side right here, which is C squared. So this formula right here is going to be what you're going to use when you have a right triangle and maybe you are asked to solve for one side. So for instance, let's say you have a building here and you are going to lay a ladder along that building, and you know that the ladder is 5 feet long, and you decide that it's the most stable when the ladder happens to be 3 feet out from the edge of the building. And let's say the ground is flat so that you make a right angle here, and you would like to know how far up that building that ladder is going to reach for you. Well, the 3 feet and the x feet, those are your legs, so that would be plugged in for your A and your B on this formula. So you would have 3 squared plus x squared for your left-hand side of this equation. The 5 here is the hypotenuse. That's the longest side, and it's across from the right angle. So the C would turn into a 5 to give you 5 squared on the right-hand side. If we solve this for x, we will know how high up that building that ladder is going to reach. And keep in mind that we're talking about a length, so in story problems often the negative value will not make sense. You'll just want to use the positive root. So 3 squared is 9, and 5 squared is 25. Now let's move the 9 over by subtracting 9 from both sides. And we have x squared equals 16. Now we're going to use our square root property to square root both sides. However, since we're talking about a length, we only want the positive value, so x is going to be 4 feet. So that means our ladder is going to reach 4 feet up the wall of that building.